Okay, Michael, so let me see if I can convince you that we have some way of actually estimating these distributions. So all I've written up here is the chain rule version of a joint probability distribution, okay? But just to be clear, what these subscripts mean here, every X that we have is made up of a set of features. So let's just say there's N of these features. And so really, X is a vector. There's feature 1, there's feature 2, there's feature 3, dot, 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 all the way up to feature N. Okay?
Sure.
What I really want to know for my P sub theta, and I'm going to drop the thetas here for the purpose of just describing this generic distribution, is I want to say, well, the probability of me seeing all of the features, all of the features of some particular example is just the joint distribution over all of those features. Now, of course, we could just estimate this, but that's going to be hard. Why is it going to be hard? Because...
Well, the first distribution is conditioned on a lot of things. So it's an exponential size conditional probability table.
Exactly. So this is exponential table. And if it's exponential table, then we need to have an enormous amount of data in order to estimate it well. And this is sort of the fundamental problem. But we have addressed this in earlier lessons, Michael.
In the inference lecture, maybe?
Yes, in the inference lecture, where we can try to estimate this incredibly painful joint distribution by making some assumptions about conditional independence. And in particular, I'm going to make one kind of assumption, and that is that we only care about what's called dependency trees. Okay, so what's a dependency tree, Michael? Do you remember?
No, I have absolutely no idea. I don't think I've ever heard of such a thing.
Ah, so a dependency tree is a special case of a Bayesian network where the network itself is a tree. That is, every node, every variable in the tree has exactly one parent.
I see. So sometimes in Bayesian networks, they talk about polytrees. Polytrees just mean that if you ignore the direction of the edges, you have a tree. But you're actually talking about the edges have to go in a particular direction. Everybody's got one parent.
Right, exactly right. So you should see these as a directed graph, although I almost never draw them that way because it's sort of obvious by looking at it that this is the root of the tree. So all we have here now is a tree. Every node has one parent. And what does that mean? That means that every node, every random variable, depends on exactly one other random variable.
Yeah.
So we can rewrite this joint distribution here now as a product over each of the features depending upon only its parent.
Oh, I see. So the first capital pi there means product, and right. The second lowercase pi there means parent.
Exactly. So when I compare this representation of a distribution, a dependency tree representation, versus the full joint, what nice properties do I get from doing it this way versus doing it that way?
Well, I guess the main positive is that you're only ever conditioned on, it's got to be at most one, right? Not exactly one.
Right, and most ones. So in fact, you picked up on a nice notational thing here. The parent of the tree, the root of the tree, doesn't actually have a parent. So just assume that in this case, pi returns itself or something, and so it's the unconditional distribution. And that could happen at any time.
Gotcha. All right. Yeah, and so like if nobody has any parents, then that's the same as naive Bayes. But here it can have at most one parent. No?
Naive Bayes has one, exactly. Everyone has one parent, and it's exactly the same one.
Oh, right. Good point.
So if everyone has no parents, then you're saying that all of the features are, in fact, independent of one another.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. But that's not what you asked. You asked comparing that probability distribution to the full joint. The main thing is that no one's ever conditioned on more than one other feature, and therefore the conditional probability tables stay very, very small.
Right. In fact, how small do they stay?
Well, it depends how big this are there binary features that we're talking about?
Yeah. Let's say they're binary.
So then it's like it's two numbers, right? It's like your probability when your parent is true and your probability when your parent is false.
Well, that's each table. But what about representing the entire thing?
So it's going to be linear in the size of the number of variables or features.
Right. And the amount of data that you need is going to be fundamentally in order to get this tree, it's going to turn out that you only need to keep track of a quadratic set of numbers, quadratic in the number of features.
We're not going to be given that tree. We're going to have to figure it out.
Well, remember, one of the steps of the algorithm is you have to estimate the distribution. So we're going to have to figure out, of all the trees that I might have, what's the best tree?
Yeah, that doesn't exactly follow from the algorithm sketch, because you could also say, well, then you need to figure out that a tree is the right thing at all instead of something else, like a box.
Oh, that's fair. But what we're going to do is we're just going to assume that we're going to do dependency trees. Now, why are we doing this? We're actually doing this for a couple of reasons, Michael. Your point's well taken. Dependency trees have this nice feature that they actually let you represent relationships. The point is that you're actually able to represent relationships between variables, which in this case are sort of features in our space, but you don't have to worry about too many of them. And the only question here then is, how many relationships do you want? What kind, which of all the possible relationships you could have where you only are related to one other thing do you want to have? Well, in some sense, a dependency tree, since you can depend on at most only one other thing, is the simplest set of relationships you could keep track of. The next simplest would be, as you point out, not having any parents at all, in which case you would be estimating simply this.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that's the next simplest. That's even simpler, but it doesn't allow any of the interrelationships, any of the covariance, essentially, information to be captured.
No, that's fair. That's a fair point. So we could have started with something like this, except here you are forced to ignore all relationships because you're treating everything as independent, and we don't believe that things are independent, or at least we think there's a possibility there's some dependence. And so by allowing at most that you're connected to one other parent, that's sort of the least committed to the idea you could still be while still allowing you to capture these relationships. So that's the basic idea. Now, I want to be strict here that the MMIC algorithm, or just this whole notion of representing probability distributions, does not depend upon dependency trees. We're going to use dependency trees here because you have to make some decision about how to represent the probability distributions. And this is kind of the easiest thing to do that still allows you to capture relationships.
I buy that.
Okay. And one other thing worth noting is, I hope you'll see this in a couple of slides if you don't see it immediately, is that at the very least, this will allow us to capture the same kind of relationships that we get from crossover in genetic algorithms.
Huh.
And that was a bit of the inspiration for this, that crossover is representing structure, in this case, structure that's measured by locality. And this is kind of a general form of that.
So you're saying if there is some locality, then however we're going to learn the dependency tree from the samples is going to be able to capture that, and therefore it will kind of wrap its head around the same kind of information that that crossover is exploiting.
That's exactly right. And in fact, as we'll see in one of the examples that I'll give you in a moment, that it can do better than that because it doesn't actually require locality the way that crossover does. There's one other thing that's worth mentioning here about this distribution and why it's nice. It captures relationships. But the second thing is something that you sort of alluded to earlier is that it's very easy to sample from, right? So given a dependency tree where each one of these features, each one of these nodes represents a feature, it is very simple, very easy to generate samples consistent with it, right? You just start at the root, generate a sample, unconditional sample, according to whatever the distribution is, and then you go through the parents and you do the same thing. So it's exactly a topological sort, and in trees, topological sorting is very easy, and this is in fact linear in the number of features.
Right, I get that, and it is exactly an instance of what we talked about when we did Bayesian inference. The thing that is new is how do we figure out a dependency tree from the sample?
Exactly, that's what we're going to do next, and that's going to involve math.